In an unexpected turn of events, many of us felt a wave of shock when B14, the first Starship booster to complete two flights, met its untimely end. The B14 mission, in many ways, exceeded all expectations. It successfully addressed the issues that had hampered its predecessors and demonstrated significant improvements in performance. Yet, despite these advances, it did not reach a perfect conclusion. So what exactly went wrong? What were the defining moments that cemented B14 legacy? More importantly, how did the accomplishments and failures of this flight impact the future of Starship? Let's dive deeper in today's episode of NR Studio. The period between B14 two flights was 132 days. During this time, it became the first Starship booster to be reused, marking a historic milestone in SpaceX pursuit of rapid reusability. B14 had previously broken the record for the most successful landing of any Starship booster by utilizing the innovative Mechazilla arm for its catch, raising anticipation for its reignition. However, the B14 mission was not just about reusability. It was tasked with a series of ambitious test objectives, including performing active somersaults, landing at steeper angles of attack, and completing a dual-engine landing burn. These challenging tests likely necessitated the decision to target an ocean landing, where any potential failures would minimize the risk to infrastructure. Unfortunately, we never saw the B14 touch the water. Moments before the anticipated landing, serious problems arose. The first signs of trouble came at T+6:15 when SpaceX activated the landing burn. This critical maneuver ignited a cluster of 13 center and inner ring engines to slow the boosters for a controlled descent. However, it quickly became apparent that one of the center engines had failed to reignite. While a single engine failure during landing isn't necessarily catastrophic, the B-15 has successfully landed in similar situations. It does reduce deceleration efficiency, a critical factor during final landing. Unfortunately, the engine problem was only the initial setback. Under standard conditions, the landing process would involve a brief burn of the center ring to slow the boosters, followed by a shutdown of that engine and a transfer of control to the three inner gimballing engines that guided the boosters to a proper landing. However, this crucial transition never materialized. Instead, at T+6:20, just 5 seconds after ignition, all engines suddenly shut down. Video feeds became distorted, and telemetry was lost shortly thereafter. Tragically, the thrusters did not reach the water, and based on available data and subsequent analysis, it is likely that B14 exploded. During its final descent, the B14 flight encountered a critical moment in the air. While this particular mission did not provide direct altitude and velocity data, insights from previous missions suggest that the landing burn typically begins about 1 kilometer above the ground. This implies that the B14 was close to successfully completing its mission, just seconds away from reaching the finish line when the failure occurred. It is possible that a nearby ship or drone may have recorded the explosion, and SpaceX could potentially release this footage in a future update. However, the root cause of this unexpected failure remains uncertain. One plausible theory points to the igniter system. Throughout its mission, the B14 engine underwent multiple ignition cycles during liftoff, booster burns, and finally the landing burn. The rapid succession of starts and stops, combined with extreme thermal conditions, may have pushed the igniter component beyond its operational limits. The system's inability to ignite or maintain a controlled burn during the landing burn could have triggered a chain reaction of failures. The explosion itself may have been the result of a secondary complication. A sudden ignition failure could have resulted in severe vibrations or internal pressure within the booster, potentially rupturing fuel lines or tanks. If a superheated propellant leak occurs, especially if it comes into contact with a spark or flame that is still present, the result could be a rapid explosion. Additionally, the use of reused hardware also plays into the equation, as most of the engines on the B14 have been flown before, increasing the risk of wear-related issues. Furthermore, the higher angle of attack during descent, intended to simulate a more fuel-efficient landing, likely increased structural and thermal stresses compared to previous missions. Despite these setbacks, SpaceX maintains a positive outlook. In an official post-flight statement, the company said, "The goal of today's test was to intentionally push Super Heavy to its limits, providing us with real-world data that will directly contribute to improving our next-generation boosters." The company asserted that safety measures were meticulously followed, As is customary for all tests, the flight line area above the bay was secured prior to launch, ensuring that no individuals or equipment were compromised during the incident, a critical aspect that could facilitate an expedited review process without requiring a formal FAA investigation. Moving forward, how can SpaceX mitigate the likelihood of a repeat of such an incident? For starters, the igniter system will likely need further strengthening. This is not unusual for SpaceX, as the company has successfully completed several engine runs on previous missions. They will likely need to assess the system's performance under V2 conditions, identify thermal weaknesses, and make any necessary adjustments. After its eighth flight, SpaceX is ready to continue this important process of analysis and improvement. Recent installation improvements have been implemented to improve ignition reliability, suggesting that similar improvements may be needed for future developments. In terms of explosion mitigation, the incorporation of a new shock absorber system and structural reinforcements could effectively absorb vibrations generated by the engine. Additionally, improvements to the pressure relief valve and fire suppression system could significantly reduce the risk of a catastrophic chain reaction during the crucial landing burn phase. We invite you to share your insights into potential causes of failure and suggest improvements in the comments section below to encourage an engaging discussion. While SpaceX faces ongoing challenges with the Super Heavy program, the B14 achievement serves as a remarkable demonstration of the progress made thus far. As SpaceX highlighted at X, the ninth Starship test flight marked a significant milestone in reusability, showcasing the first flight-proven Super Heavy booster launch from Starbase and successfully returning Starship to space. Clearly, reusability is a prominent feature of the B14. The booster has previously completed one flight, and on its second mission, it continued that momentum with 29 of its 33 engines also being reused from previous trips. Despite some engine issues, the overall performance was commendable, especially considering that some Raptors have now flown three missions. Take Raptor 31, for example, which first operated on its fifth flight with B12, then on its seventh flight with B14, and again on its ninth flight. Each mission tested the limits of engine endurance and rapid turnaround. One of B14's most notable accomplishments was successfully executing a boost back burn, a maneuver that had posed challenges for B14 and its B15 counterpart on previous flights. This time, all 10 center ring engines reignited flawlessly, guiding the booster back to its landing zone, marking a major milestone on the road to rapid reusability. But the testing didn't stop there. B14 also introduced a new concept known as an active flip. Rather than relying solely on aerodynamic forces, SpaceX cleverly blocked off certain vents, allowing thrust from ship 35 to rotate the booster with precision. This flawless separation and controlled maneuver highlighted the potential for implementing fuel-saving orientation changes and optimizing fuel margins for future orbital payload deliveries. This was followed by a quick payload release, captured in stunning detail by onboard cameras, which SpaceX CEO Elon Musk hailed as a remarkable achievement by the team. The visual of the ring of fire ejecting from the booster as it prepared for its final descent was a testament to the program's progress. All of these milestones paved the way for the 10th flight, which Musk said could happen as early as June. Although B14 planned landing ended in an emergency, the progress made during this mission has laid a solid foundation for future efforts in the SpaceX Super Heavy program. In a recent analysis of SpaceX's latest mission, it's clear that the results of the latest flight have not changed the company's future options. The team has two viable paths. They can continue with a tower-based recovery approach, bolstered by their growing confidence in the capture technique, or they can opt for another ocean landing to focus on refining their high-angle descent and optimizing the final burn using two engines. These goals are in line with the ambitious agenda for Ship 35. During its most recent flight, Ship 35 successfully completed the ascent phase without an engine failure, demonstrated the ability to reignite an engine in space, and demonstrated that its improved heat shield tiles could withstand the intense heat of reentry, a significant accomplishment. Future missions are set to focus on a variety of objectives, including deploying payloads from orbit, performing engine reignitions during orbital maneuvers, enduring the extreme temperatures of reentry, and ideally performing a soft landing at Starbase, potentially even utilizing the tower arm. Achieving these goals is critical to realizing full reusability of both stages. In just a few months, Booster 14 has overcome some of SpaceX's early hurdles. While the latest flight, the 9th of May, not be as impressive as Flight 7's perfect capture, it still provides valuable data and strengthens confidence in the gradual progress toward rapid routine reusability. B14 is truly a frontrunner pushing the boundaries of reusable technology and a critical component of the Starship initiative's progress. If you appreciate its contributions, consider leaving a B14 in the comments and subscribing to our channel to stay up to date on SpaceX's exciting journey. In contrast, significant changes are afoot at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory, JPL, but of a different nature. Recent reports have revealed a major shift in workplace policies that has raised concerns among the lab's more than 5,500 remote employees. In anticipation of proposed budget cuts, which are still under review, JPL has announced that its pandemic-era remote work model will be phased out. Starting August 25th for staff in California and October 27th for those in other locations, the lab will require a full return to on-site work. JPL leadership has stressed that failure to meet the deadlines will result in termination. The decision follows significant staffing cuts at JPL in February and November, when about 855 employees, about 12% of the workforce, were laid off as part of a restructuring or project cancellation. Many remote workers now worry that the push to return to in-person work is actually a thinly veiled strategy to further reduce staff without having to provide severance packages. As one JPL employee told colleagues, it's clear this is a silent layoff of over 1,000 remote employees who they don't want to pay severance to. Beyond concerns about job security, many staff members are highlighting the practical issues associated with the abrupt policy change. Concerns have been growing about the abrupt transition at JPL, especially since many employees live hundreds of miles away from Pasadena, making daily commutes impractical. Additionally, some are dealing with property damage or displacement stemming from the Palisades fire in January, making it difficult to return to campus. The situation is compounded by concerns about parking shortages, cramped office space, and inadequate support services, all of which contribute to a climate of uncertainty. Despite assurances from JPL leaders that they are ready to accommodate everyone, skepticism remains prevalent among staff. In particular, JPL leadership may not have anticipated the upheaval. The policy change was disseminated internally rather than through NASA headquarters, coinciding with the departure of Lawrence Leslie, who is stepping down as JPL director effective June 1st. With budget cuts and workforce restructuring looming, staff at the lab are bracing for the possibility of further disruption. The scenario at JPL underscores the far-reaching impact that budget challenges can have on NASA's mission and its personnel. Beyond the immediate implications for employee livelihoods and morale, the policy shift raises critical questions about the future of remote work in high-cost, high-security research environments. As NASA prepares for the next administration, all eyes will be on how NASA navigates these hurdles, balancing financial constraints with the need to attract and retain the talented workforce essential to advancing America's space exploration. That's it for today's episode, and see you next time, and thank you for your support.